York, 1975. Una ciudad a punto de caer en la bancarrota y un lugar carente de diversión. Londres, 1975. No era mucho mejor. Ambas ciudades habían perdido el rumbo. Un grupo de jóvenes músicos y sus admiradores pensaban que el rock también. En ambos lados del Atlántico buscaban reconectarse con el verdadero espíritu del rock.
The toughness, the rawness, the total rawness, the simplicity of it. There's no messing about, you know?
Durante un breve periodo se tocó música llena de pasión y furia. El punk. El punk era una conversación entre dos ciudades. Londres aprendió de la actitud y el estilo de neoyorquinos como Patti Smith y se inspiró en los sonidos minimalistas de los Ramones.
When I heard the first Ramones album, it was like I plugged my finger into an electric socket.
Pero bandas londinenses como los Sex Pistols y The Clash luego crearon un punk rock que era puramente británico.
They sang in their London Cockney voices about things they knew about in the language of the street, and it felt truthful and honest and passionate.
Los Sex Pistols eran despectivos y soberbios. Componían música polémica y cargada de ira.
It's not put on. There's no airs or graces about it. You know, we suffer.
Ambas ciudades tenían algo en común, el deseo de que el punk se convirtiera en un estilo que uno controlara, música en la que uno pudiera ser uno mismo, haciéndola uno mismo.
Just like anything went. The door was open to do what you want to do. If you had an idea, you could get on and do it. And we kind of put the key in the door.
En esta historia de dos ciudades, de lo peor de una época surgió lo mejor de una época y la tercera edad del rock. Punk rock, Blank Generation. En el verano de 1974, cuatro inadaptados sociales de Queens comenzaron a tocar en un nuevo club nocturno del Lower East Side de Nueva York. El club se llamaba CBGB. La banda era Los Ramones.
The first time I ever saw the Ramones play, I think they did about 16 songs in 12 minutes, or maybe it was 12 songs in 16 minutes.
We didn't want to bore the audience, you know. I mean, we wanted to get on there, do our thing, and leave. I mean, you know, people have lives to live, you know. we don't have to waste their time. We just wanted to do our thing and get it over with.
So funny but smart, so mad with, you know, determination, and so serious and intense, you know. It was really just, they were great. Always have been. I mean, just, I loved them from the first.
Those insanely revved up tempos, the look, the sound, the attitude. Without the Ramones, this program probably wouldn't exist.
That's what I had always hoped, that when kids see the Ramones, that they feel that they can go out there and do this too. That's what rock and roll was supposed to be about. Late 60s, things got away from that. People started overindulging with long solos, and you started, you know, you watch somebody like Jeff Beck or Jimi Hendrix, you feel like, you know, you have to practice for 20 years to build and play this song.
El sonido que salió de la guitarra de Johnny Ramone definió a la banda.
The thing about Johnny was that since he wasn't going for the usual virtuosity, he created his own virtuosity, and his virtuosity was downstrumming very fast.
The songs were so crude, no solos, only bar chords, but they were so catchy at the same time. But the lyrics were so crazy, Queen street kid, you know, about sniffing glue and beating on the brat with a baseball bat. And it was like brilliant. I loved it.
He wrote about things that affected us, you know, directly, you know, like songs were like a release for our frustration and getting at our aggression, and you know, the songs dealt with feelings of alienation and, you know, isolation and all kinds of just feelings, you know.
Everything just sort of happened without any really conscious effort. We just sort of fell into our style as we went along. We wanted at first to, we thought we were playing bubblegum music, you know, it was sort of like a sick bubblegum music, you know, which became punk.
Un año después, en Londres, otro grupo de marginados del rock comenzó su propia campaña para destrozarlo y volver a comenzar. Los Sex Pistols se formaron en King's Road, en Chelsea, cuando se vio a un chico llamado John usando una camiseta fuera de lo común.
It's just because I had an I Hate Pink Floyd t-shirt on, you know, I mean, for a laugh, you know. I had not much in my way of clothes, but I did have a Pink Floyd t-shirt, and I just wrote I Hate on it. And look, it launched a career. Is that luck? What is that?
En Sex, la tienda preferida de un tal Malcolm McLaren, tuvo lugar una audición fuera de lo común. El chico de Finsbury Park hacía que cantaba con la máquina de discos de la tienda.
We did have an Alice Cooper song called I'm 18, which I did know, because I liked Alice Cooper. That was a fine man. Nobody wore a corset quite like him.
Los demás chicos de la banda miraron a Johnny y enseguida supieron que tenía algo fuera de lo común.
It was like an odd scenario. I mean, miming to somebody else's records with this bloke you've hardly met. And he was embarrassed, but he kind of put on this kind of weird front, which was interesting. Couldn't sing for Toffee, but there was something about him.
I couldn't sing a note, never ever tried, all right, but I liked it. I grabbed it by the testicles and ran with it from there on in. I know, hence the squealing high tones.
Los Sex Pistols hallaron un espacio para ensayar en el oeste, en la calle Denmark, en el Soho. Era Tin Pan Alley, el histórico hogar de los mejores productores del pop londinense.
We had a base, you know, we could leave our gear set up, we had somewhere to hang out, we had somewhere to practice, and we did. We was there practically every day. You couldn't hear nothing because of the horrible noises we were making, but maybe that was kind of good.
Aquí aprendieron a tocar haciendo covers de clásicos del movimiento mod como Substitute de The Who. En 1976, los Pistols habían empezado a tocar en vivo y su reputación crecía con sus caóticas presentaciones en lugares inverosímiles, como el Club 100 en la calle Oxford.
The Pistols were not really like a typical performance or a typical concert where, you know, you pay your money, you go, you're entertained. It was more like some sort of spontaneous confrontational art happening.
You learn your chops on stage, you know, you do. You know, you learn all your stage movements according to where the bottles are coming from. And there was an awful lot of that. People hated us.
Para que los Sex Pistols fueran más que una banda que hacía covers, necesitaban escribir sus propias canciones. Para hallar los primeros destellos de inspiración, Malcolm McLaren los persuadió de ver una banda que acababa de conocer en Nueva York.
La banda era Television, conformada por Richard Hell y Tom Verlaine. Los de Television estaban decididos a hacer música provocativa.
It had to do with aggressively not looking to please the audience, playing songs that are kind of psychotic, the way the world felt, but also lyrical, but really loud and physical, and everything ragged, but intense.
Pero tan importante como la intensidad punk de la música era que Richard Hell tenía una imagen muy clara de cómo debía ser la banda, y eso impresionó a McLaren.
Malcolm saw Richard with, you know, his chopped up clothes and his hacked off hair and his gorgeous sunglasses, and thought, this is the look of the future. This is what rock and roll is going to look like.
McLaren también quedó impresionado por el mensaje nihilista de una canción que Hell había escrito llamada Blank Generation.
I did, you know, I did think it would be interesting and fun to try to distinguish the way things look like to me from, you know, hippies or beatniks or whatever.
Great weekend. It's a thriller, and his next number is called I Belong to the Blank Generation.
I was saying let me out of here before I was even born. It's such a gamble when you get a face. It's fascinating to observe what the mirror does, but when I die, it's for the wall that I set in place. The window as the doctor cursed. He was a cartoon long forsaken by the public eye. The nurse adjusted her garters as I breathed my first. The doctor grabbed my throat and yelled, God's consolation prize. Voice clarifying blank, you know, because that's the whole point. It's empty, it's blank, there's no, it's up, you make it up.
En Londres, los Sex Pistols tomaron la idea de Hell de una generación en blanco, pero la aplicaron en un contexto muy británico en el que se mostraba en crisis no solo a una ciudad, sino a todo el país.
With this real air of desperation, there was a, practically a hung parliament, there were power cuts, there was rubbish piled high on the streets. You know, the three-day week. It was just a real feeling of despondency. And I saw this blank generation idea, and I thought, yeah, you know, I could use it somehow. And came up with this pretty vacant idea.
Para hacer el fraseo, el bajista Glenn Matlock en broma recurrió a una influencia muy poco punk y muy poco bohemia. ABBA.
One of their songs, there's a bit in it, and it doesn't have that riff in it. But when there's a thing that goes... And you can hardly hear it, but it just set me thinking.
Where are those happy days? They seem so hard to find.
The most moronic riff you can get is... Well, kind of that. It's a not... It's the same note. So I'm fiddling around, you know, what is it? Off, got a riff, you know, it's the most straightforward, moronic, Dada-esque kind of riff to go with this idea. Pretty vague. It was one of the very first best of songs and dealing with something other than what your normal pop group deals with. You know, so it became a bit of a manifesto somehow. You know, a mission statement.
Con Pretty Vacant, los Sex Pistols hablaban de su generación y por ello comenzaron a cambiar vidas.
Someone the same age, you got what he was saying. You didn't feel like, oh, he's scary, shouting at me, he's telling me to fuck off. You know, no, you understood that he was saying, get off your asses, do something. I'm not doing it the same way everyone has done it before, and like it or piss off.
It was so new that you realised you'd have to go home and start shedding quite a lot of the baggage you took around with you. It was like being reprogrammed.
Los Sex Pistols fueron la chispa que unió a otra banda de punk, The Clash. El cantante Joe Strummer vio la luz luego de que los Pistols tocaron antes que su antigua banda, los 101ers.
I remember the Pistols show was curtailed suddenly by a fist fight that actually spread from the stage, actually. And we all saw this, and it was like, and it kind of overshadowed, in a way, Joe's performance afterwards, or it was like the old and the new sitting in the same place. And I know that it was a marking point for Joe, and he went like, this is the new thing, it's coming now, I can see that. You can't change the way the things are going, really. And he said, oh, I'm going to get with this, you know, the new thing that was coming in.
Punk rock, Blank Generation. En 1976 había otra influencia de Nueva York. Una cantante que dejó muy en claro que todo podía ser posible si uno tenía pasión. Patti Smith.
She was one of these very strong poet performers. And with a razor sharp mouth, I would deliver.
Wow, God, I must leave.
Visceral. It was about language. It's a language. And mind what the music's doing. The music's doing fine, but the language, it's spitting out something that goes right in the head. It was very good.
Me.
La banda de Patti Smith fusionó la poesía performática con el rock de tres cuerdas. Tomaron un clásico de los 60, Gloria, le agregaron un poco de crítica social y lo hicieron punk.
It was fairly natural. The way she read poetry seemed to have a rhythm and a melody to it, and so it was very easy to attach chords and rhythm underneath it. Having grown up with rock and roll, those three classic chords, we gravitated toward that. It was fun. I mean, we enjoyed the sense of twisting this form.
Patti
Maddie Smith was absolutely astonishing. She was absolutely vital to, you know, laying the foundations of punk. Her voice, her clothes, her stage presence, her movements. She was almost like a freestyle rapper. The sentiments she was voicing, Jesus died for somebody's sins, but not mine. Iconic imagery. It had a street realism that was unmistakably punk, couldn't be any anything else.
La banda de Patti Smith grabó su primer álbum en los estudios inmortalizados por Jimi Hendrix, El Electric Lady en Greenwich Village. Le pidieron a John Cale de Velvet Underground que produjera el disco. Fue el espíritu punk el que dio forma a la canción más importante del álbum, Horses.
Is it a punk song? Well, it's got three chords. Because they were really easy to pulse. You could just go underneath and it would kind of provide a soundtrack. You could talk over it, sing over it, slow it down. And you could get really fast. And it allowed the song to travel.
It builds and it even changes rhythms from like sort of a shuffle feel to that sort of garage band, straight four and four feeling. There's no syncopation. There's it's not funky. It's very, you know, made by honkies for honkies, you know.
Horses tuvo un impacto inmediato cuando se la presentó. La tapa del álbum con una fotografía de Robert Mapplethorpe era algo nuevo en la iconografía del rock.
She's wearing a man's shirt. She's got a man's jacket over her shoulder. Her tie is loosened. She's very extremely slender. It was a shock at that time to see a woman be proudly a woman and yet so androgynous and, you know, not caring whether she was gratifying the traditional male expectations of what a woman needs to be sexy. Place called space.
It's a pretty little place. La actitud punk de Patti Smith era una revelación para los británicos que buscaban nuevos ídolos.
It was utterly mind-blowing. It was her, everything she sang about, every way she, the way she released all the words, the free flow, the strength of it, the passion of it, and the utter contemporaneousness of it all as well. It was like, this is it, this is it, this is my soul on record.
En mayo de 1976, los admiradores británicos pudieron ver a su heroína por primera vez. La banda de Patti Smith tocó en el Roundhouse de Londres, a sala llena. Grabaron una especial para la BBC. Después aceptaron una invitación para ver a los Sex Pistols en su guarida, el Club 100.
Someone, I think it might have been Chrissy Hynde, said, you have to go down and see this band. And they called the Sex Pistols. And I thought, wow, interesting name. And went down to this grungy underground pub. I think it was the Club 100. And they took the stage and they, you know, immediately before they even started playing, you know, Johnny Rotten started saying, "Oh, did you go down to the roundhouse the other night and see the hippies shaking the tambourine? Horses, horses, oh shit!" And I thought, man, that was a quick 15 minutes, you know? It's like we're already obsolete.
La burla a estos admirados artistas punk de Nueva York dejó en claro las diferencias entre ambas ciudades.
The London bands were younger, they had a lot less art theory, they had not necessarily more politics, though some did, but they had a lot more class rage, no matter how unfocused and unexpressed. It was class rage. Fundamentally, the New York punks were bohemians or aspired to be. The London punks were yobs or aspired to be.
Los Sex Pistols expandieron la misión de su banda de destruirlo todo al resto de la nación. Viajaron a los estudios Manchester del Canal Granada.
You can hear them warming up in the background even now.
En su primera presentación televisiva, tocaron su segundo gran himno, Anarchy in the UK. Lydon cantaba impulsado por una furia fría. Sus letras eran una brutal expresión de ira.
As an angry young man, I still am probably an angry old man. You're not going to take that away from me. I don't think my feelings about how society has downtrodden my kind of working class people, I don't think those are false emotions at all. It's not put on, there's no airs or graces about it. You know, we suffer, and you can fuck off for it.
Pistols appeared on that program playing Anarchy in the UK. It seemed almost inconceivable that the performance was going to stay inside the TV set, and it was like Rotten was going to crawl out the screen and into your living room and be right there in the room with you. It was one of the most utterly immediate things I've ever seen on television.
Anarchy in the UK marcó un intento real por enfrentar al rock establecido.
It's anarchy in the UK, and so that shows an ambition. Here was something, here was a group that was not afraid to say, right, you know, we are going nationwide. This is it. This is about the whole of the country. It's not just about, you know, a couple of clubs and a couple of hundred kids in London. It's and Manchester, wherever. It's actually, this is about the whole country.
En el verano de 1976, en Londres y en el resto de Inglaterra, hubo una explosión de creatividad. Brian James tocaba con su nueva banda, The Damned, y percibió algo en la atmósfera.
It was a Brian thing. You'd see, like, first of all, to be like a few people, and you'd talk to them after the gig, you know, and stuff like that. And then the next thing, you'd see them, and there'd be another couple, and it would be the same out on the sticks. There'd be maybe one punk amongst all this, like, sea of long hair, and then there'd be a few more. and then it's just gradually built and built and built. And you'd see people making their own clothes, which was the cool thing. You know, they'd make their own statements. You know, have people like sort of living out their fantasies, if you like. That was the cool thing about it. That was a very, very cool thing. The audience become part of the whole show, become part of the whole event, you know, the experience.
El punk estaba regresando al rock, al lugar al que pertenecía.
You know, it was about self-interpretation, empowerment, individuality. Doing your own thing, I can't, you know, tell you how much this DIY thing, how important it was. I mean, it worked for me. I mean, I reinvented myself through the whole punk rock thing. I mean, when it kicked off and everybody's picking up a guitar, I wanted to pick up something too, but very quickly the stage was full up. So I picked up a Super 8 camera and reinvented myself as a filmmaker. And Super 8 films, they only lasted about 3 minutes. And luckily for me, everything the punks had to say fitted into 3 minutes. Even when I interviewed them, they usually ran out of things after about 2.5 minutes. So it was hard and fast and stripped down.
Punk rock. Blank Generation. La influencia más importante en el primer sonido de las bandas punk del Reino Unido era el minimalismo acelerado de los Ramones de Nueva York. Los Ramones grabaron su primer álbum en cuestión de días en un estudio del Radio City Music Hall.
It was done quickly, inexpensively, and it sort of suited our ways of working anyway, you know, with the impatience of the band and everything. So in a way, it lent itself to the sort of the lo-fi interesting quality of what it became. And so the first album is sort of kind of a statement of its own.
La primera canción del álbum fue una de las mejores de toda esta revolución punk. Blitzkrieg Bop.
I was walking down the street, and it just occurred to me, well, it'd be great if the Ramones had a chant song.
Let's go!
I was in the Sloth, actually. It happened in the Sloth. I was playing Joey's guitar, and as I was playing the Joey's guitar, I just started playing Blitzkrieg Bop. It just came to me. And that night I went home and I wrote the song. You know, I put together the Hey Ho, Let's Go with that, and I took it to the next rehearsal, and that was Blitzkrieg Bop.
Canciones como Blitzkrieg Bop pronto gustaron a las bandas que se formaban en el verano punk del Reino Unido.
It was that kind of like a rallying call. Oh, hey, oh, let's go. And you know, I mean, not really philosophical lyrics, but it was about doing things. It's been about punk being about action, really, rather than just theorizing.
When we first heard the Ramones album, how influential that was, because it was just like totally, like, really short songs, really hard attack, no nonsense, and it was just like cut down bare to the bone, you know, and it was like, that was inspiring.
Inspirados por la fórmula despojada de los Ramones, The Clash hizo sus primeras apariciones.
They looked great as a three-man front line. Strum was a great front man, as good as Lydon. So visually very strong, and it was very hard and fast. It was, you know, one, you know, a two-minute wonder after another. What's my name? Cheat. career opportunities. Just really good, you know, fantastic song.
Every job they offer used to kick you out the dock. Career opportunity, the one and
Si bien The Clash se inspiró en Nueva York, llevaron su música en una dirección completamente nueva. Crearon un punk que era un estilo de música de protesta comprometida con el mundo.
While John Lydon, Johnny Rotten, had a rage against the system, Joe Strummer had a more evolved, more finely tuned sort of political awareness. You know, he regarded his ancestors as people like Woody Guthrie. He regarded himself as a leftist, whereas John fully regarded himself as a Johnist.
I think the difference between us and the Pistols was that they were like, had their massive impact, but they didn't offer the same kind of hope that we did.
The Clash escribió canciones basadas en su experiencia, en el lugar en el que ellos vivían en Londres, a fines del verano de 1976, el carnaval de Notting Hill terminó con una pelea entre la juventud negra y la policía. Joe Strummer y Paul Simonon quedaron atrapados en el tumulto. A raíz de eso, The Clash se sentó a escribir una canción inspirada en el incidente White Riot.
He was down there, me and him, and we got searched by policemen looking for bricks, like, and then later on we got searched by Rasta looking for pound notes in our pocket, so...
All we had was bricks and bottles. But still...
was about people, white people getting up and doing it for themselves, because our black neighbours were doing it for themselves insofar as the riots and whatever, so it was time for the white people to get on with their own situation, which I suppose was the beginning of the punk thing.
Generation. En 1977, Glenn Matlock se fue descontento de Sex Pistols. Lo reemplazó Sid Vicious.
Sid was the perfect cartoon punk in terms of standing there in his leather jacket, pulling comic aggro faces in photographs. After they got rid of Glenn, they got some great photos taken, but they never again wrote a decent song.
Cada vez les costaba más tocar en vivo. Los Pistols modernizados grabaron la última gran canción escrita en conjunto por Matlock y Rotten.
Save the Queen is just a rant, right? It's chorusless, but it seems to be a proper song, but it ain't. And I like that. It's rules are for fools.
God Save the Queen fue presentada durante el verano del aniversario de Plata de la Reina y fue publicitada con una campaña de comercialización brillantemente anárquica.
With all that build-up, with all that feeling, it's incredibly exciting. It's incredibly well-drilled. Everybody's on it like that. Had these fantastic lyrics. England's Dreaming and Tourists and Money, The Mad Parade, wonderful lyrics.
Hubo una estrategia publicitaria brillante. Un viaje en barco por el Támesis durante la noche de las celebraciones por el aniversario.
Did you know what we were up to? You know, singing Anarchy and God Save the Queen outside of the Houses of Parliament, as loud, as raunchous as you like, was a good thing, you know, a good statement, a good day out in Rotten World.
And then it has this rather desolate and very emotional chant of no future at the end, where the rest of the band join in, and that was kind of very touching as well.
These are subjects never discussed before. To even think of the royal family as subject matter in a song in any way but lauding their wonderfulness was, a no-no and considered a crime.
En 1978, los Sex Pistols, cansados de enfrentar problemas constantes en el Reino Unido, fueron a los Estados Unidos para demostrar a los Yankees quiénes eran los verdaderos punks. Pero los Estados Unidos terminaron con los Sex Pistols. El fotógrafo Bob Gruen fue testigo de la pública autodestrucción de la banda. Vicious era el más autodestructivo de todos.
I tended not to be in front of the stage. I tried to get on the side and watch the action from a little bit of distance because I didn't want to be in the fray. It was like a battleground in front of the band. I mean, one night I remember Sid was sort of had this interchange between these girls in the front, and at one point a girl kind of motioned for him to come a little closer, and he leaned over and she punched him right in the nose, and he had blood pouring out of his nose and down his face and chest and a big smile on his face, like he really enjoyed it. I had never seen anybody react that way to being punched in the nose. And then he started taking the blood and splashing it back at the girl, and she was spitting it back at him, and then I think the blood started to dry up, and he went over to his amp and he took a bottle and he smashed it on the amp and started cutting his chest, basically to make more blood, I think, to keep the game going.
Terminaron su última presentación en San Francisco cantando No Fun, un guiño para los padrinos del punk, Iggy Pop y The Stooges.
You'll get one number and one number only, because I'm a lazy bastard. This is no fun. No fun, my babe. No fun. No fun, my babe. You're no fun. Fun to be alone. Walking by my street. Fun to be alone. We'll love. When the body
No fun. I suppose all of us felt that. It was no fun. It was really no fun at all. I really, really got the pain of that song. We took it to the extreme edge of really no fun.
Oh, bollocks, why should I carry on?
This is really not fun. And it wasn't.
It's no fun at all. No fun. Ever get the feeling you've been cheated? Good night.
At the very last gig, ever get the feeling you've been cheated? It was directed straight at the whole world, including us, because I was feeling cheated by that point.
Tras la separación de los Sex Pistols, The Clash intentó que el punk siguiera siendo honesto, que se mantuviera cerca de sus admiradores y que conservara su compromiso político.
You do the same thing, and who wants to know? After a while, you know, makes people sick in the head to do that. So we have to always try new things, you know. And like everyone's a load of sort of like sheep, you know, going, nee, it's horrible, nee, it's nice, you know. But they don't fucking know.
The Clash decidió explorar una gama de influencias, desde el rockabilly hasta el reggae, en su álbum de 1979, London Calling.
It was really The Clash who, having begun as a defining punk band, then attempted to see what else they could turn their hands to, applied their talents to a whole other bunch of styles and influences, and demonstrated that while you still have the punk gene, as long as you don't lose it, you can take it anywhere.
En la época de London Calling, The Clash había viajado desde los extremos del punk hasta el corazón del rock y por un tiempo se convirtió en la banda más importante del mundo.
Like,